Tonight, no end in sight for the nation's rental woes. A new report revealing what we knew was bad just got a whole lot worse. And the housing crisis is colliding with a huge surge in migration. Let me hit you with the numbers.
Hit me!
1.1%. That's the number of properties available to rent right now. A record all-time low.
Going.
And that has sent rents soaring, up 6.7% in the regions and more than 12% in the capital cities. The national median rent now $550 a week, 10% higher than last year.
We're really not building enough houses at the moment, and part of that is that interest rates have increased so much that it's harder for people to make projects stack up. We're seeing a lot of builders going into liquidation as well.
The supply squeeze coinciding with a record surge in migration.
It's certainly part of the issue we're facing in the rental market. We clearly just don't have enough housing for the amount of people that are demanding housing at the moment.
In the 12 months to March this year, our population has grown by more than 560,000, 81% of that coming from net overseas migration.
We need politicians listening to those on the ground that are saying that the congestion, the pressure on schools, roads, hospitals and welfare and housing is becoming too much.
It's the largest annual migrant intake on record and more than double pre-pandemic levels, with calls growing for a temporary cap.
This is a problem of putting the cart before the horse. The government is bringing in a significant number of people, record numbers, without the infrastructure to provide for them. So there does need to be a re-evaluation of the numbers that are coming in.
But the other argument? Immigration fills workforce shortages and drives economic growth.
Certainly capping migration could have unintended consequences. You know, migration is a great benefit to the country. It makes us more diverse. It helps replace our ageing population. But, you know, drastic times where we don't have enough housing supply, maybe we do need to consider doing something like that for a short period of time.
So with too many people competing for too few homes, how big is too big for Australia?
Abul Rizvi was a senior Immigration Department public servant under the Howard government, and he has some thoughts. First up, why do you think we are hitting these unprecedented immigration numbers?
Well, there's two short-term reasons and one bigger long-term reasons. The two short-term reasons is the government was really much too slow in tightening policies that were put in place during and prior to COVID. And secondly, we had a massive shortage of workers, a really strong labour market that's continued right through 2022 and is still continuing through 2023.
We've all seen these queues.
But the bigger reason...
Go ahead.
The bigger reason that I think we ought to be concerned in this space is the reluctance of both major political parties to commit to a long-term net migration target. And the lack of that commitment means net migration can fluctuate much, much more than it would otherwise be the case.
So, Abul, you would set a net migration ceiling, a number on that, would you?
I wouldn't set a ceiling. I would set a long-term net migration target, recognising that through the economic cycle there will be fluctuations, but I think by setting a target you achieve two things. One, you put a discipline on ministers who freelance in terms of developing new visas, new migration arrangements, new immigration policies with no discipline around them. And secondly, it would help all of our government agencies, major businesses, etc., plan better. Plan better in terms of housing, plan better in terms of infrastructure, government service delivery and so forth. It would be enormously beneficial to both of those areas.
So it looks like migration is going to shape up to be a major election issue. So is it good that we're talking about this?
It's good that we're talking about it. It's bad if it's going to become an election issue. Immigration as an election issue is never good. Immigration is best managed, and our history shows this, when there is a bipartisan approach to immigration, as there was, for example, right through the Menzies years.
What are you worried about? What does the immigration election look like to you?
I think it looks ugly. I think it looks like lots of misleading comments and statements from ministers, often just throwing numbers around willy-nilly with little regard to explaining those numbers to the Australian public. Even worse than that would be if we get right into some serious dog whistling, which is always a possibility when immigration becomes an election issue.
So if you were running immigration policy again, what would you do? Say, let's say a block of 5 years, what would you do?
I would firstly commission a proper study that determines a long-term target for net migration for Australia. I would put in place a framework around that which put discipline on ministers to, if they're going to come up with bright new migration and visa ideas, they're required to show some discipline around what the implications of that are for net migration. And if they can't show that that can be fitted within a long-term target, well, your idea doesn't fit. I think if we can do those two things and get bipartisan agreement to doing both of those things, we will be a lot better off than experiencing the kinds of blowouts that we're experiencing now.
So, yeah, well, you're talking sense, but I can see behind your right arm a really offensive Collingwood Premiership mug.
Oh, yeah, I do see that.
And I find it very difficult to take insights from you in those circumstances.
I'm really looking forward to the day, Waleed, that I can entertain you in my house because I have six of those mugs.
And
we could drink out of those for some time.
No, we couldn't.
Disregard the entire...
I think Steve's offended too. I mean, everyone's offended. Yeah. We're going to have to go. Thanks, mate. Appreciate your time.